Velvet Underground's third album, simply titled The Velvet Underground, is a paradox. It's a Velvet album without the defining features of their previous work. No more searing guitar tones and droning viola. Now they've been replaced by acoustic guitar and a tambourine. Gone are the songs about heroin. Now they're recording love songs and spiritual hymns. Avant-garde songsmith John Kill is out. The young Doug Ewell is in. They recorded the album in L.A., 3,000 miles away from New York, the city they were known for embodying. It's kind of hard to believe that the music within this album was even recorded by mostly the same band that made songs such as Venus in Furs and Sister Ray. It's such an outlier. If the first two albums were jarring for the musical establishment of the day, then the third album must have come as an even greater surprise to people who actually liked the band. The departure of John Cale is probably the biggest reason why the third Velvet album sounds so different from their previous work. There's a little bit of dispute, actually, over why he left the band at this time, but it's generally accepted that Lou Reed started to view the Velvet Underground as his band, and Cale as a threat to his essence as leader of the group. In the larger context of Reed's life, this actually seems fairly apt for him. He was notoriously difficult to work with and often dropped people from his professional life, as he did with David Bowie, after Transformer later on in the 70s. Cale's, well, firing caused a rift in the band too, since both the other Velvet bandmates Sterling Morrison and Maureen Tucker didn't want Cale to leave the group and were frustrated with Reed's decision. There's also some speculation that the band's manager at the time, Steve Sesnick, helped drive a wedge between the band. Sesnick, who possibly saw two strong creative heads, being Cale and Reed, as a headache, and tried to pump up Reed's ego as the band leader. To replace Cale, the band, seemingly on a whim, or maybe just out of desperation, hired 22-year-old Doug Ewell without even so much as an audition. There's a cheeky anecdote that Ewell was hired simply because he was a Pisces and would balance the other astrological signs of the band well. Ewell himself actually claims this, and Reed apparently was heavily into astrology at the time, so, you know, maybe it's true, I don't know. Why is this album their second to be self-titled, though? It's not unusual, of course, for a band to simply name an album after themselves, but two? Maybe this was another power move for Reed. The Velvet Underground and Nico isn't solely a VU album, with Nico there, which wasn't even Reed or the rest of the group's desire. And perhaps White Light, White Heat is too tied to John Cale. The second self-titled album is the first album without all of the members Reed ousted from the band. Maybe self-titling this album was to reintroduce the band as what he had increasingly been seeing as his band. In another twist that is equal parts similar and dissimilar to the previous albums, the Grey Album, as it's often called due to its grayscale cover, features several songs that Reed does not sing lead on. The Velvet Underground and Nico, of course, has, you know, Nico doing lead vocals on three of its 11 songs. On White Light, White Heat, John Cale leads both The Gift and Lady Godiva's Operation back-to-back. Now Kill's replacement, Doug Ewell, does lead and co-vocals on three of the songs here, and Maureen Tucker has her vocal debut. Still vocally collaborative, just with different people. I'm a big fan of bands that have multiple lead singers, too. It usually gives the records a certain freshness and variety that's really special. Sterling Morrison described the sound of the record as anti-production. This seemingly was a conscious decision, at least on Reed's part. Characteristically of Reed, he was easily bored with ground he had already tread, and was constantly moving on to new ideas. He knew the band shouldn't do a repeat of White Light, White Heat, saying, "I thought it would be a terrible mistake, and I really believed that. I thought we had to demonstrate the other side of us. Otherwise we would become this one-dimensional thing, and that had to be avoided at all costs." Morrison claims the difference in approach was due to the band's effects boxes being stolen and that they decided to see what they could do without them. Doug Ewell actually says this is a false rumor though, since it would have been pretty easy to replace their gear in LA where they recorded the album. Morrison also seemed somewhat ambivalent about the album at the time, too. John Cale's departure allowed Lou Reed's sensitive, meaningful side to hold sway. Why do you think Pale Blue Eyes happened on the third album with Cale out of there? That's a song about Lou's old girlfriend in Syracuse University. I said, "Lou, if I wrote a song like that, I wouldn't make you play it." My position on that album was one of acquiescence. Maybe he was just peeved about Cale being kicked out of the band. The rift between Reed and Morrison would only grow onto their next album as well. Doug Ewell joining the band made waves too. His tender, spacey background organ replaced the upfront piercing effects of John Cale's electric viola and his own organ playing. The new organ sound is a real highlight across the record, too. It gives it such a meditative and serene sound that washes over, compelling you into a euphoric state of mind few other records can achieve. Reed described the simple drone of the organ in their live performances at the time as heaven music, which is a pretty appropriate description of the sound on this album too, especially with many of the religious and spiritual undercurrents. Another strange aspect to this record is that there are actually a few different official mixes. After Val Valentin mixed the original, Reed went into the studio and remixed the record without the band's knowing or approval. This is actually the mix that ended up on the original vinyl released in 1969 in the United States, although for whatever reason the Valentin mix was released in Europe. This mix is lovingly referred to as the closet mix because of a quote by Sterling Morrison about how he thought the record sounded. Later CD reissues of the album switch back to the Valentin mix for whatever reason. The two versions are actually pretty different too, at certain points at least. The Valentin version has a much crisper sound, and there are even entire instruments that are missing on the closet mix. Some Kind of Love in particular uses a noticeably different vocal take too. It feels weirdly fitting for an album that has so many conflicting aspects to it to just have conflicting mixes as well. I actually think I prefer the closet mix personally due to its more muted, isolated sound, but that also might just be because it's the one I listen to first and still the most of.
Well, happiness to me is being in Hollywood and being in films and giving happiness to other people.
Candy says the first song on the album was inspired by Warhol star and transgender woman Candy Darling. The song opens the album on a soft but deeply depressing note, which instantly kicks you out of any hopes of the Velvets repeating White Light, White Heat. Candy says, I've come to hate my body and all that it requires in this world. This line and the whole song, of course, can be read as a song about Candy's troubles regarding her gender identity and her desire to be emotionally satisfied and accepted. Candy says, I'd like to know completely what are the so discreetly talk about. I hate the big decisions that cause endless revisions in my mind. These lines develop a clear sense of Candy's struggle with how she perceives herself and relates to other people. It's an early, and still probably one of the strongest, pop songs about being transgender, another example of Lou Reed's committal to writing songs highlighting people and issues often ousted or swept under the rug in his time, and really still our time. Candy Says portrays a narrative of dissatisfaction that anyone trans or otherwise can deeply relate to. Reed considered it to be one of his best songs and thought the song had far-reaching appeal, saying it was about something more profound and universal. A universal feeling I think all of us have at some point. We look in the mirror and we don't like what we see. I don't know a person alive who doesn't feel that way. Doug Yule actually sings the lead vocals to this song too, something I didn't actually realize for years after first hearing it. Reed would go on to sing about many LGBTQ matters, like in the song Makeup on Transformer. I imagine Reed, being bisexual himself, may have found Candy Says to be easily relatable and portray ways he thought about himself and his place in the world as well. Issues regarding self-actualization through sexuality and spirituality are prevalent throughout the rest of the record.
Candy says, and I hate those quiet places.
In an incredible live performance of the song, Reed plays guitar with vocalist Anohi, who herself is a transgender woman. It's truly a deeply moving rendition of the song, and I particularly love seeing Reed's speechless expression after the song concludes.
Anthony.
Reed would perform again with Anohi and the Johnsons for his final live performance before his death in 2013.
What goes on here in your mind?
The second song on the record, What Goes On, is a straightforward rocker compared to Candy Says. This is the introduction of Doug Yule's organ, too, and it gives the song a drone quality somewhat similar to the band's previous work with John Cale, albeit much softer. According to Reed's rough guide to the album, What Goes On is a direct response to Candy Says. The song is told from the perspective of the character across from Candy in conversation. In response to Candy's woes about her life, this character asks the simple question of, what goes on in your mind, and attempts to reassure them. Some pretty conflicting sounding lyrics here, which will continue as a theme as the album progresses.
I'm going up and I'm going down. I'm gonna fly from side to side. 1 minute 1, 1 minute 2. 1 minute up and 1 minute down.
In the song's context, they represent the ebbs and flows a person goes through in their life, much like the turmoil Candy extols on the previous song. The guitar solo in the middle of the song is one of my favorites, too. It's pretty simple and just tuneful compared to Reed's previous solos, like the jagged one on Hear Her Call My Name just a year before. It's such a cool sound, too. It almost feels like a fleet of bagpipes more than a guitar. They got the sound by recording 5 or so different takes of the solo and just couldn't decide which one they wanted to use, so they decided to overlay them all together into one hectic sound that just sounds really great. Reed's emotive performance of the song gives it an almost uplifting feeling, too, as he shouts out the chorus, "Baby, be good, do what you should, you know it will be alright." It's just a rare moment of straight uplifting positivity in the Velvet Underground catalog. Some Kind of Love is one of Reed's finest moments as a songwriter. It concerns another dialogue, this time between characters named Margarita and Tom, in which one tries to seduce the other to explore themselves sexually. In Reed's idea for the larger narrative of the album, Some Kind of Love extends the discussion in What Goes On to the subject of love. The man in the conversation talks about all kinds of love being the same as long as it's love. And that's what he says to her over and over and gives different examples of it. He's trying to reach her and she's saying, like, "I don't understand." Sterling Morrison's stuttering guitar licks are one of a kind, and Reed considered them to be some of his best work. Tucker's banging cowbell gives the song a driving, pounding backing beat that really pushes the song forward in a suggestive way. Vocally, I think this is as close as it comes to sounding like Reed is having a good time, especially on the Closet Mix version. The song deals, of course, with love, and is a declaration and maybe even protest in support of the concept of free love.
And no kinds of love are better than others. Like a dirty French novel, the absurd courts the vulgar.
Reed, who was bisexual, although he never really used that term to describe himself, was writing and singing about issues that were becoming more prominent in American society at the time. Non-heteronormative forms of sexuality were often featured in his songs, like in Walk on the Wild Side, which also references Candy Darling. Some Kind of Love could probably be considered one of these songs too, except it doesn't explicitly reference any sort of sexuality specifically. Reed was a master of lyrics that require some reading between the lines, and I don't think it's a stretch to include love outside heterosexuality in the message of this song. John Cale once said that, "To Lou, everyone is gay." I feel like that's really the core message of Some Kind of Love. It's a plea to open yourself up to other ways of thinking and to be vulnerable and explorative and share it with others. Reed, through the words of Tom to Margarita, is asking you to take a chance and let us do what you fear most, whatever it is, and to put on your red pajamas and find out. Weirdly enough, in another contradiction, Reed would later on in his life walk back some of the wilder, more sexually adventurous aspects of his personality. He would even later say in an interview that this gender business was often just a way for kids to rebel against their parents. Some Kind of Love, of course, also contains one of Reed's most famous lyrics.
Between thought and expression, lies a lifetime.
A beautiful summation of his life and work. It contains just so much meaning in 7 words. It's a line that's come to be associated almost as much as Walk on the Wild Side with Lou Reed, and was even used as the title of the 1992 compilation of his solo work, as well as a collection of selected lyrics of his songs. Pale Blue Eyes is my favorite song on the album. The conversation between the two at the core of the record turns from the sexually charged concepts in Some Kind of Love to a specific kind of love, adultery. Reed wrote the song about his college girlfriend Shelley Albin, although he says her eyes were actually hazel, apparently. Shelley Albin was recently married, and throughout the beginning of her marriage, Reed would often plead with her to leave her husband to come back with him. Reed would even name-check Albin on I Can't Stand It, which they recorded around the same time. It also contains more of Reed's paradox songwriting, notably in the opening line, which is also one of my favorite lines of any song.
Sometimes I feel so happy. Sometimes I feel so sad. Sometimes I feel so happy, but mostly you just make me mad. Baby, you just make me mad.
Reed allegedly was having an affair with Shelley Albin around this time too. Although there's very little info to suggest this from my research, it does give the song more weight knowing that the adultery here was reality rather than simply fiction. Reed even refers to it as a sin, another explicitly religious reference. Betty Kronstadt, Reed's first wife, seems to doubt Reed's true feelings for Shelley Albin, interestingly enough. She found Reed to want to idolize and fantasize the women in his life more than actually truly love them, that he would often chase the idea of love but would push away those who he was actually able to get close to. Kronstadt claims that Reed used Albin in a similar way that he did to her. He was a misogynist. I was his princess in a certain sense. But as much as you idolize someone, you might resent them too, because they are not real to you. Musically, the song is sublime, and the peak of the trance-like quality of the album. A really sparse arrangement, guitar, background organ, and Mo Tucker's thumping cowbell replaced with a lazy tambourine. The song is so much more than the sum of its parts. Equal parts relaxing and heartbreaking, it's arguably Reed's most emotionally pained vocal performance of his career. Combining Reed's pained lyrics and vocals backed with such simple yet deeply emotional music makes this song pop for me as a highlight in the Velvet catalog, and still stands as one of Reed's finest love songs.
Linger on, your pale blue eyes.
The fifth and final song on side one is Jesus, a song about Jesus. Except it's not, well, at least according to Reed. He said that the song has nothing to do with religion, but is a search song. Interpreting the song that way, it really carries the same message anyways. It's pretty clearly about a character seeking redemption for their sins.
Jesus, help me find my proper.
It makes sense to follow several songs about dissatisfaction and sadness with a direct appeal for finding my proper place. Referring again to Reed's framework for the record, Jesus is also about love, like the previous songs. He specifically refers to it as religious love. Maybe the love that's covered in this song is the one that Reed is asking for forgiveness after committing the sin present on Pale Blue Eyes. The song is one of the most distinct guitar and bass tones of any song you'll hear, too. It gives the song a haunting quality which reinforces the pained, pleading lyrics as Reed almost whispers them out. The almost spectral vocals at the very end of the song always gives me chills, too.
Jesus, Jesus.
Opening up side two is Beginning to See the Light, another powerful rock tune. Reed's wildest vocal performance on the album really pumps this song up as a quick start to side two. Another song that chugs along, similar to What Goes On, it's a brief respite of energy compared to the lazy desperation of Pale Blue Eyes and Jesus. Reed says that narratively, this song directly follows the quiet desperation of Jesus. The character is looking forward after his prayer, feeling optimistic after seeing the light. The song still contains doubts, though, particularly in the bridge, which musically takes a step back from the straightforward rock for a softer, more reflective approach.
Here we go again, playing the fool again. Here we go again, acting hard again. All right!
Some pretty cynical lyrics that contradict the uplifting message of the rest of the song. The character is still angry and unsatisfied despite whatever spiritual awakening they may have undertaken in Jesus. The song ends on a pained note similar in tone with the bridge, with the anthem,
"How does it feel to be loved?"
This line is impactful on a couple levels. For one, Reed says this is from the perspective of the character in the larger narrative of the album. The character in this song, presumably the same as the one pleading to Jesus for salvation and asking Candy what's going on in her life, asks the question because this person doesn't know, in his words. It can also be taken tongue-in-cheek, too, in like a snarky way, especially coupled with these previous lines.
"Here we go again. I thought that you were my friend."
It's as if this character is resentful to the person opposite them. It's poignant coming from Reed at this point in his and the Velvet Underground's career. Commercially and critically unsuccessful, the Velvets were strapped for cash, on the verge of a breakup, and just couldn't find their audience. They could barely crack into the top 200 and watch bands they inspired and came up alongside with grow to international acclaim. And yet here they were, in Los Angeles recording their third album, performing to shows of maybe 50 to 100 people at a time, and still struggling. "How Does It Feel to Be Loved" is the depressingly acerbic moniker of a band too cool and too out there to care how it feels to be successful. This is also the song on the album that maybe most explicitly references one of Reed's strangest obsessions at the time, the writings of Alice Bailey. Bailey, a major author in the New Age scene in the first half of the 20th century, wrote books on enlightenment and white light as a healing power. Reed discusses in a 1969 interview his fascination with this concept. "I've been involved and interested in what they call white light for a long time. A woman named Alice Bailey who has some rather remarkable books out. She was a telepathic secretary. It's kind of an incredible book, a treatise on white magic. It tells you how to go out and do it all." It's possible to see Reed's fascination with white light continuing to be an influence onto their third album, especially on Beginning to See the Light, for obvious reasons. Music critic Ellen Willis highlights the desire of salvation inherent in this song, similar to that found on Heroin. She notes the irony of the song, commenting on the paradoxical nature of some of the final lyrics.
"There are problems in these times, but woo, none of them are mine."
Enlightenment has begotten spiritual pride, a sin that, like in its inverted form, nihilism, cuts the sinner off from the rest of the human race. Especially from those people who, you know, work very hard but never get it right. Finally, we are left with yet another version of the spiritual paradox. To experience grace is to be conscious of it. To be conscious of it is to lose it. This is the illuminating core of the Velvet Underground, a desperate plea for acceptance, whether it be sexual or spiritual, contrasted by a detached, nihilistic coolness.
"How does it feel to be loved?"
I'm Set Free is another arguably religious song. Brian Eno covered the song on his 2016 album The Ship, and in an interview said this, "That particular song always resonated with me, but it took about 25 years before I thought about the lyrics. I'm set free to find a new illusion. Wow. That's saying we don't go from an illusion to reality, the Western idea of finding the truth, but rather we go from one workable solution to another more workable solution. Subsequently, I think we aren't able and actually don't particularly care about the truth, whatever that might be. What we care about is having intellectual tools and inventions that work." This chimed well with, "I'm set free to find a new illusion. It seems to me what we don't need now is people that come out waving their hands and claiming they know the right way." I'm Set Free contains more conflicting lyrics too.
"I've been set free and I've been bound."
This re-highlights the conflicting tone present on Beginning to See the Light. This is one of the most anthemic Velvet songs, complete with dual jangly guitar, Tucker's consistent thumping drums, and Reed's transition from soft crooner during the verses to basically shouting at the chorus. You could see how artists like maybe Bono were influenced by this one. The song builds in such a beautiful way. The guitars and drums grow in aggression as the song builds each chorus and explodes as Reed belts out. The overdubbed background vocals that grow around each chorus are a nice touch too. Jesus, Beginning to See the Light, and I'm Set Free work as a triplet of spiritual journeys. Jesus being the folksy search song, as Reed puts it, Beginning to See the Light as the continuation of that journey towards enlightenment, and then I'm Set Free as the finale in which this character finally finds their new illusion. Taken as a whole, if the first side of the record is about asking questions and presenting ideas and issues related to love, self-actualization, and dissatisfaction, then side two seems to imply acceptance and insight.
And now, I'm set free.
That's the Story of My Life is the shortest song in the album and has the most concise lyrics. Just five lines, the song is based on the words of Billy Name, a member of Warhol's factory and casual sexual partner of Reed at the time, who also took the photo of the album's cover. A simple and mostly acoustic song that goes on for just 2 minutes, it sums up the paradox at the core of the album, the difference between wrong and right, the difference between good love and bad love, light and dark. The character at the center of this narrative explains that they've spent their life struggling to decide what to do with themselves, trying to decide what's right and what's wrong. But then, Billy swoops in to let us know that there really isn't a difference.
That's the story of my life. That's the difference between wrong and right. But Billy says, both those words are dead. That's the story of my life.
The characters throughout this album have been seeking resolution. Candy with her body, the character in Jesus who has fallen out of grace, and Reed himself in That's the Story of My Life, who has finally learned the difference between wrong and right. It's worth noting how two of the songs on this album are inspired by people he was having romantic relations with. The mysterious affair with Shelley Albin inspired Pale Blue Eyes, and the cover photographer Billy Name in That's the Story of My Life.
That's the story of my life.
The shortest song with the fewest lyrics is followed by the longest and most lyrically complex song on the album, The Murder Mystery.
Candy Screen Rappers looks fantastic. Quiet memories, but lovely and guilt-free. We're in love with twilight pages. Flushes down your throat with laughter. Lock on a cable's on me for the passion. What would justify my spurious desires? Rectify moments my serious and urgent. Inhale up in the face of my slowest time. Crying replies most fast and vacuous. With words nearly cinched with the heartbeat of passions. Forth with the grace of the talk going on.
The most dense, obtuse lyrics of Reed's songwriting career, The Murder Mystery is 9 full minutes of lyric jargon and organ noodling, the closest to the avant-garde trance of their previous albums. It's distinct. I won't even begin to decipher the lyrics to this one. I don't think I'm smart enough for that, so feel free to read through them and decide for yourself. It's very difficult to decipher many of the lyrics just listening, too, since, you know, there are two fucking people talking at the same time. The main idea behind the narrative significance of this song, in his words, was this. All this unintelligible stuff. You know, but the intent was really noble. I just mean, finally after seeing the light, explaining everything and getting things right, and finally saying, now I got it right, bam, what happens? A whole new series of problems. Reed found The Murder Mystery to be a creative failure. The idea was to affect the listener with two monologues with opposite emotional impacts. He hoped that by listening to both at the same time, you might be laughing and crying at the same time. Of course, this doesn't really work because the two speakers are, you know, talking over each other and it's difficult to make out what either person is saying. Ironically though, I think I actually find this failure to enhance the song. It helps add a sense of confusing finality to the root concept of the album. The Murder Mystery is one of those songs that's enhanced by smart album sequencing too. Coming right after That's the Story of My Life, a song that implies finality, and honestly you'd expect to close an album with a song like that. It feels like some surreal nightmare of words and sounds, completely contradicting every soft, subtle vibe of the previous 8 songs. And of course, it's bookended by one of the VU's best songs, After Hours, which works like a hard left-turned coda to The Murder Mystery. The outro is pretty unpleasant, with a repeating piano line that grows and grows and just gives you anxiety until it finishes with some atonal key smashing. It's an exceptionally weird way to end an exceptionally weird song and puts you in a terribly jumbled headspace to experience the final song of the album.
One, two, three. If you close the door, the night could last forever. Leave the sun shine out. And say hello to never. All the people are dancing and they're having such fun. I wish it could happen to me.
After Hours, the album's closer, is another real highlight for me. Another weird juxtaposition, too. The grueling murder mystery is preceded and followed by the two shortest and simplest songs on the album. And this song is deceptively simplistic at first. A pretty straightforward Tin Pan Alley-esque song, After Hours is delightful, mostly due to Mo Tucker's bluntly imperfect performance. Reed himself didn't want to perform the song, choosing Tucker to sing it instead. You still don't hear that kind of purity in vocals. It has nothing to do with singing. It has everything to do with being. It's completely honest, guileless, and always was. I couldn't sing that song. Maureen could sing it and believe it and feel much more, because it's about loneliness. Someday I know someone will look into my eyes. It can be so sappy and trite. But with Maureen doing it, especially being just a little off-key, it has its own strength and beauty and truth to it. Reed was exactly right. Tucker's earnest, flawed performance gives the song a unique quality that would not have shown through had he done it. The simple, pleasant acoustic chords and Tucker's quaint vocals perfectly juxtapose the absolutely heartbreaking lyrics. A soft ode to the seductive quality of After Hours bars, the subject of this song is struck with a profound loneliness that they seemingly have no intention of quelling. It's a bitter note to end the album, and again contradicts any self-actualization found in I'm Set Free or That's the Story of My Life. I wouldn't really expect anything different from the Velvet Underground, though. A band lauded for their avant-garde ideas and intense subject matter, it would be kind of out of character to end the album on a happy note. Taken as a whole, the album is a complete masterpiece that puts you into a frame of mind that is almost spiritual. A spiritual paradox that will take you on a journey of pain and redemption. You can also begin to see the larger narrative that Reed intended after analyzing it as a whole as well. The conversation he envisions in which two people discuss different kinds of love, from love through sexuality to religion. The album portrays a person's attempt to understand themselves and what their place is in the world, to learn the difference between wrong and right, and finally discovering that there is no difference at all. The messaging of the album is complex and honestly a bit jumbled, but helps to portray a state of mind that's paradoxical in an attempt to see the light. The Grey Album's themes are as complex and contradictory as its lead songwriter often was. Notoriously mean and sometimes emotionally and physically abusive, Reed was troubled with failed friendships, relationships, and numerous solo albums. His first wife, Betty Kronstad, claimed he was the devil incarnate to many people during their marriage in the 70s. There are a number of accounts of him being a harsh, emotionally distant, and manipulative person. He was very good at ousting people, and was ostensibly never satisfied with his work or personal life. He would often straight up mislead journalists in interviews, and was notorious for making outrageous claims about himself and for contradicting past statements he made.
Do you want people to take drugs themselves? Is this perhaps why you sing about drugs?
Oh yeah, I want them to take drugs.
Why is this?
Because it's better than Monopoly.
The Velvet Underground is a defining document of the band as well as who Reed was. Often contradictory and crude, sometimes maddeningly overambitious, but also often brilliant and expressive in ways few other artists are. Although the Grey Album was their first to pick up media attention and receive some glowing critical reviews, the album did even worse than the first two records and failed to even creep into the Billboard Top 200. MGM, their label at the time, ended up dropping them after the album too, after they realized they were just losing money on them. MGM president Mike Curb even released a statement saying, "Groups that are associated with hard drugs are very undependable. They're difficult to work with, and they're hard on your sales and marketing people." The fact that MGM basically didn't promote the band or album at all, essentially sending the record to die, didn't seem to occur to him, apparently. The Velvet Underground would go on to release one more album in 1970, Loaded, but Reed would leave the band shortly before release. It's very well documented now that they never really received commercial or critical success in their years as a group, but would eventually go on to be remembered as one of the greatest and most influential bands in rock music. Their ability to sway from the drugged-out avant-garde explosions of their debut and White Light, White Heat, to the quiet meditations on the Grey Album, to the straightforward rock and roll of Loaded, is a big reason why they're remembered so fondly today. The few that found and loved them at the time consider them one of the finest bands of their era, though. Lester Bangs, music critic, Reed admirer, and sometimes Reed antagonist, reviewed the album in 1969, praising the band and the album, saying, "It will still go a long way toward convincing the unbelievers that the Velvet Underground can write and play any kind of music they want to with equal brilliance." This is truly what makes the Velvet Underground so impactful. that a band that pushed rock music so far to the point of breaking, creating their own unique form of art in the process, could do away with so much of what made them special. They were able to strip down their sound and still come out with a masterpiece unrivaled by most any of their peers. The Grey Album, with its confounding paradoxical lyrics and music, and contemplative concept album narrative, is one of the best albums of the 1960s, and has proven to be one of the best works of art of the 20th century.
'Cause if you close the door, I'd never have to see the day again. I'd never have to see the day again. Once more, I'd never have to see the day again.